And welcome to this special interview on money control. We are in conversation with Infosys co-founder, chairman, and Aadhar architect Nandan Nilekani, as well as Tanuj Pojwani, who is a fellow at Icefruit Foundation. And we're in conversation with them on their brand new book, The Art of Bitfulness. As the book says, it's about keeping calm in the digital world. I've managed to read the book. It was my first book of 2022, and I'm really happy that I picked this one. A lot of useful tips, tricks, actionable insights on how you can get the best of technology and how you don't allow technology to enslave you. Basically, how you can make tech work for you better. As the authors themselves say in the book, it's not anti-tech, but pro-you. Thank you both very much for joining us. Nandan, let me start with you. This is your third book. I remember reading Imagining India many years ago, and then there was Rebooting India. Both of those were about how you can leverage technology to build a more inclusive India, equitable India. This one is about how we need to use technology better. So, is there, a contrast between this and the previous two ones? Was it a natural evolution? If you can give us your thoughts.
Yes, Chandra, you're right. My first two books are really big policy books, policy and technology books. But what we realized is that while that's of interest to a few people, what people also would like to know is how they can become more effective in their own day-to-day life. And therefore, we felt that taking this angle of focusing on how to use your technology better would be far more useful to a large number of readers. And this book came out of regular walk in the parks that Tanuj and I used to do. And we both felt overwhelmed by what was happening with the pandemic. Our digital interactions had gone up. Everything we are doing was working from home, video calls, ordering food, e-commerce, everything was digital. And of course, then all the other activities. So we felt that maybe there's value in doing something to make people improve their digital hygiene. And then we compared notes about the two ways that what his approach and my approach. And though they're very different at a detail level, they're conceptually the same approach to be on top of your technology. And that led to this book. But let me add that this is not just a book on what you and I can do. It's also a book about why we are the way we are. What is it that about the technology choices made in the last 20 years that has brought us to this? And what are possible ways to deflect that at a collective level? So that's very much there, but we lead in with the personal and then take you to the collective approach.
Right. In fact, I'm going to stay on the personal for a bit before I move to the collective approach, the societal approach, which is, the final part of the book. So, also very interesting insights on how both of you interact with technology, interact with devices. For example, Nandan does not use WhatsApp. I don't know how he survives without it. He uses Twitter mostly as a broadcasting medium, but no other social media. So, if you have to reach him, it's only calls and messages. Tanuj uses WhatsApp, but he also has, a system in the way he uses WhatsApp. So if both of you can tell us how this evolved, did you reach a point where everything just became too much and you needed some system to follow in your lives?
Well, it's also a question of at what age you got your technology. I mean, my first device was a computer, first a large desktop, and then, of course, a laptop. And my main communication on digital was email. So that's a long habit. It's 25, 30, whenever it began, 25 years back. And then I got my smartphone only in 2010 or thereabouts. Therefore, it's only, I was already 55 by then. So I didn't really depend so much on the newer communication media. And also I realized that I like to, finish things, close things, reply to people. And if I have too many open channels, then I'll have too many unanswered messages. So I said, let me curtail it. I will stick with voice and SMS. I will not use any social media. I do use Twitter, as you said, as a broadcast mechanism to my followers. I have a zero inbox strategy, so I do mail twice a day and make sure there's nothing pending. And I use my iPad as a for my curated content. For example, I read subscription papers or I watch movies and also I have a very clear definition. My laptop is for work, my phone is for communication, my iPad is for curated content and entertainment. And what I found was Tanuj had a similar thing. I thought everybody can afford to have three devices like I have. So he has a system where using one device and using software and multiple identities, he essentially achieves the same goal.
Tanuj, actually Nandan's strategy seems simpler. In your case, it's about VPNs and multiple identities. And, you know, I mean, I'll have to do some 20 different things to safeguard privacy and, you know, reduce social media. This is a simpler hack. Just keep three different devices for three different use cases. Tanuj, I think you're on mute.
I'm sorry. I did that because there were some construction noises in the background. Sorry. You're absolutely right. It is a little more cumbersome if you want to do this. But the idea in this book and what we are doing is always that there are no hacks in this book. There's like systems. And for each system, we tell you let's learning a piano, learning any sort of musical instrument. This teach you with a chord, right? Like they'll say, play C, play A or whatever. And then they'll be like, now play this song by Guns N' Roses or something like that. So the idea is that the system that I talk about is, like you said, evolved from OWN. And it is with the idea that I personally, like Nandan said, would get overwhelmed if I have to have three different devices and stay focused on each device and close my laptop, pick up that the iPad instead, charge those things. So for me, the physical devices being too many seems overwhelming. The way that I really do it is that these are all one-time investment efforts. So I've created multiple user logins on my laptop. So every time I open my laptop, I basically am asking a question, what am I doing on my laptop right now? And if I'm looking to do deep work or when I was writing the book, I actually had an account called Writer Bhojwani, which just had just the writing tools, nothing else in it. So if I log into that account, I simply no longer have any temptation to get into something distracting. So these kind of strategies work and they're obviously customized to your life. The book seems like it has a lot of them. But you pick and choose the ones that you are more appropriate to you.
Nandan, one can argue that, you're Nandan Nilekani, so you don't have to connect to everyone all the time. You don't have to stay on top of everything, that, things will reach you. You don't have to chase information or curation or entertainment. So, are there broader common principles that the rest of us lesser mortals can apply in our lives? Because I can't afford to not have WhatsApp. I can't afford to not engage on Twitter.
No, I think... You should be on Twitter. You're in the news business and you need to see breaking news. And often Twitter is the best place for breaking news. I also know that I think you have a lot of Google alerts on maybe 500 people or something because you just pick up stuff on Google alerts is my sense. I'm not sure.
I have a Google alert that says Nandan Nilekani.
Yeah, you probably have that for 200 people. I mean, not just me. So, I mean, in your business, you have to do that. But that doesn't mean that you use them indiscriminately. You can still use them in a very, for example, you're writing an important analytical article, then certainly for that duration, you want to operate in a create mode. And you don't want interruptions coming every 5 seconds while you're writing because interruptions are distractions. I mean, if you're writing an article and you have a device next to you and it gives a notification, your temptation is to go and see what that notification is about. So, even within information-intensive job like yours, I think there are a lot of rules that you can follow. And let me tell you, I am on top of everything. Just that I don't need to be on a Slack channel. I don't need a constant interruption. A lot of my work is actually connecting the dots and thinking things through. So, I rather have free time to think than 2 million useless interactions.
Right. Let me actually ask you a follow-up question. One very interesting part of the book is about how writing is thinking. And, you've cited examples of how Warren Buffett has used this, how Richard Feynman had extensive notes. And he didn't see it as a record, but he saw it as thinking. It was thinking for him. You also spoke about unique systems that people like Azim Premji have and Sharad Sharma have. Considering you're straddling so many different worlds, there's Infosys, there's the work that you do with the government on, be it UIDAI, UPI, now, ONDC and so on. What is your system, the way in which you organize different aspects of your life?
Well, a lot of it is my folder management. I have email folders that are very, very extensive. And I have 20-year-old folders. You can look at my laptop, you'll see a folder from 1999. And they're well organized. So I know if I need something, I can go and get it. And also, it's a great way of closing something. For example, when I joined the UIDAI to do the Aadhaar project, I would have had 20 different UIDAI folders, one for legal, one for HR, one for government interaction, one for media kind of thing. And ultimately, everything I did, I will finally make sure it gets stored in one of them. So even today, I can go back and find something from 20 years back. The second thing is that I don't believe in having a long to-do list, because to-do lists themselves create issues. I'd rather close the thing just on time. So I always make sure that I have a time gap between two meetings. And then after the end of the first meeting or the whatever meeting it is, I then spend a few minutes thinking about what are the action items out of that. Should I call up somebody, email somebody? Should I write something up? And I do that immediately so that that's closed. And then, I have a strategy of doing my email once in the morning, once in the night, and maybe a couple of more times if I get time. And I try to go to a zero inbox strategy. So what happens is that with all this is that, you're just on top of things. And once you're on top of things, then you feel relaxed and calm. And by staying away from, and I don't get into arguments on Twitter or, those kind of things. So I'm not really into getting into that. So that also helps me to stay calm. I'm not into some polarizing stuff that people seem to be doing all the time.
Right. But Mr. Nalekani, how tough is it to kind of remain, a little indifferent, even when they're talking about you or when they're talking about Infosys or when they're talking about Aadhaar? How have you sort of developed that mindset over the years?
Well, I think, if you have been in public life, as I have been, you learn to get a very thick skin. I did, I must admit that when I first went into public life, I began with the BATF, but really in a big time was really doing Aadhaar full time. I was actually quite shocked and stunned by the criticisms and the sneak attacks and all that stuff that goes on. But after a while, I said, look, this is part of the territory. You want to do this, you want to do massive change, you have to accept that this is going to happen. So I've developed a very thick skin now, and I'm very, very calm and cool. So whatever anybody says, I don't react, and I just focus on what I have to get done.
Right. Tanush, your system?
My own system is that I think I get anxious or I get worried or I feel like I can't focus if there are things in my head. So the things in my head come down to this one place. I use this software called Roam Research for this. People are welcome to do whatever, including a journal, which is what Nandan does, a physical journal. But don't keep anything in your head. When you write it down, what is in your head, and don't try to write down things perfectly. Like, this is something that I actually had to get over, and it was a problem because I like to write. And therefore, you want your sentences to be nice. But then really, once I got over that fear and basically started writing every thought in my head on paper or on Roam in this case, I would then be able to see what I am thinking. And when you can see what you are thinking, you can see the holes in your thinking. So you're able to improve your thinking. So the process from going from stress to action is writing for me. And I use a software called Roam. I've said, I think, three times, somebody should pay me for this, is useful, but it's, again, it's a reflection of who I am. I really believe that this is, the software isn't important. It's really about what works for you, but don't keep anything in your head. That's the real system. And then once it's down on paper, you can, either, like Nandan said, close things, send an email, do the thing, make a call, just don't just keep having a growing backlog of things that you need to do, because then again, you're stressed, you're worried.
Got it. We've covered the individual part, the system part. Let me get to the collective, the societal efforts. And, you have spoken about how internet has evolved, how, internet advertising has evolved to the detriment of us, the users of all these big tech apps. You've also spoken about how regulation is like, taking a knife to a gunfight. But why do you think Web3 cannot solve this problem? Because in the part on Web3, you've mentioned its advantages, but you've also said, you know, it's like a plutocracy and there's also worry about collusion. So why do you think decentralization is not an answer for this in terms of how, you know, we can take back control from technology and build a decentralized internet?
Well, I think the siren song of this Web3 is decentralization, where you ostensibly take charge of your own life. But the reality is that there is as much centralization in this world of crypto and so on as there is in the old world. So essentially, you will end up exchanging old set of gatekeepers for a new set of gatekeepers. And I'll give an example. If you look at crypto exchanges, the three or four of them dominate the world. And they decide the rules of the game, and you know, they can deny you a transaction. There's a recent article by the CEO of Signal about how he couldn't get his NFTs back because the exchange decided not to give it to him. So there are going to be new gatekeepers who are going to be there, and these gatekeepers also have a role over the system. I mean, if you look at Binance, which is the largest thing, they also have the third largest cryptocurrency, right? So that means you are both an exchange and you are a currency provider. Now, that's no different from, you know, we always said that we should e-commerce platforms should not do self-preferencing and should not, you know, put their branded products ahead and all that. So how is that different from an exchange also being in the currency business? So I don't buy this argument that you have perfect decentralization. I think what crypto has done, and the genius of crypto is not, and maybe the technology is great, I'm not saying it's not, is they have decentralized money making. See, that's the beauty of crypto, that they're decentralized money making. So the 13,000 coins, everybody has a new blockchain, everybody has a new set of coins. Then everybody now has an interest in promoting it because his value of his holdings goes up. So if I go and buy some Ether and Bitcoin and AVAX and all that, then I'll suddenly give interviews saying it's the greatest thing since sliced bread because then the value goes up. So frankly, its smartness is decentralizing money making. There's been no technology in history where you decentralize money making, and that is the real brilliance of it.
So, you know, then what should India do in the way it looks at crypto? I mean, it's still hanging fire. We don't know what the government is going to do, but what is your take?
Well, I think crypto as an asset class should be encouraged. Today, the world has maybe $2 trillion of crypto. It fell from $3 trillion to $2 trillion in the last month or so. And those are assets. They are assets against which you can lend or assets which you can use. So I think having that asset pool available to India is a good thing. So certainly we should treat them as not as a transactional currency, because they are, you can't really get high volume, low cost transactions. But as an asset class, I certainly think India should look at that. And certainly there's a school of thought which believes that should be done. But you see, what I'm saying is that it is not it's not the only thing. There are many, many things. There are certain uses, but there are other things we can do to rectify some of the challenges we had from the first round of commercial internet.
So Web3 is not sort of the panacea for all ills, so to speak.
In fact, we try to be very fair to the crypto guys, and our chapter on crypto also explains the strengths and weaknesses and all that. And we also talk about the Indian alternative, which is what we have built using digital public goods, where a combination of the state and institutions like NPCI and all have created a much more interoperable, much more competitive systems which a billion people are able to use. And that in the social real world, I think that actually has had far more impact.
Yeah, in fact, let me just come to that. You've proposed digital public goods as a policy alternative instead of regulation. You've said that it will have a higher impact. You've cited examples of the impact that Aadhaar has had, UPI has had, and you know, Beacon or in ONDC will have in the future, the account aggregator framework as well, which went live last year. But you know, all these digital public goods have also had issues in the past, and you know, they might have issues even going forward. Aadhaar, for example, has come under fire for being exclusionary. It doesn't handle exceptions that well. UPI, people talk about concentration risk for NPCI, which is why RBI came up, you know, with the idea of an NUE. So is there a perfect solution? Is there an optimal solution? Are we just transferring risk from private corporations to the government, or you know, a group of entities that have come together?
No, I think you know, there are no perfect solutions. The fact is that what the pandemic has shown us is that we have no choice but to be in a digital world, and we have to seek solutions that are beneficial to society and beneficial to the individual consumer. And we have tried to propose that for both. Now, for example, Aadhaar has reached 1.3 billion people. It's the most widespread ID in the country, probably in the world. So it's not clear to me why you would call that exclusionary. And authentication rates are 99%. So I think we should not overstate these issues. And UPI has reached 4.5 billion transactions. Today, when I go for a walk, I see the vegetable cart vendor accepting UPI payments. And that to me proves that, you know, it has really reached the common man. And once the account aggregator comes along, millions of small businesses will be able to use the digital footprint of invoices and all that and get credit. And ONDC will completely transform e-commerce. And e-commerce is very important to have open commerce, because if you're going to buy more and more things online, and India is going to be a $1 trillion retail economy, and if 20% of that is going to be online, then $200 billion of things will be bought and sold on the internet. And therefore, if you have a way for smaller companies and retailers to participate in that, I think it's a big social good. So there are very thoughtful reasons for why the digital public good approach is very, very good. And I think over time, people are going to see the value of it globally.
Right. On that note, let me come to the final part of the interview, which is going to be a rapid fire with you and Tanuj. Same question for both of you. Both of you can quickly answer. iPhone or Android?
iPhone.
Android.
Okay. Clubhouse or Twitter Spaces?
Neither.
Twitter Spaces.
But Nandan did make a debut on Clubhouse. I remember covering
that. I made a debut on Clubhouse because Karthik of Bloom had some event and he wanted me.
On crypto, incidentally.
Yeah, so I said okay, and that is my first and last appearance on Clubhouse.
Kindle or physical books?
Physical books, definitely.
Physical books for leisure, for pleasure, but Kindle for research, right? Taking notes.
Okay. Night owl or early risers?
Night out before 30, early riser post 30.
I have to unfortunately copy that answer. Yes. Since I started writing this book and have control of my time, I've become an early riser, but I used to be a night owl.
Favorite note taking apps?
My notebook, old kind notebook. I write things down.
How many notebooks do you have, sir? Do you have it for different things, or it's like one big notebook?
It's a big notebook and it has sections in it, and I'll not show it to you because it's too much of really strategic stuff in it, which I will not show you.
I will get a year's worth of breaking news if I get access.
No chance.
Tanuj?
Room research. Found it last year in the middle of the pandemic, has stuck. It's been very useful.
Okay. Infosys or Aadhaar?
Both.
I have no skin in the game in this question, but if anything, Aadhaar, because I really genuinely think people misunderstand it, because the headlines are about exclusion, etc. And the people who read these headlines, you know, in the English speaking audience, are not the people who really need Aadhaar. So they haven't really seen the stories that I have seen through my work.
Right. On that note, thank you both very much. And yes, wishing you the best, and hopefully the art of bitfulness will help all of us keep calm in the digital world. Thank you both very much for joining us on Money Control.
Thanks, Chandra. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.